Hi, everyone. I'm Anya Parampil, and you're watching Red Lines. I have a special report to bring you today, featuring interviews with two important guests. The first recording you will hear is a brief conversation I had with Jordan Goudreau, the U.S. Army vet who recently took responsibility for leading Operation Gideon, a failed invasion of Venezuela carried out by at least 60 Venezuelan military defectors, as well as two former U.S. Green Berets. Afterwards, you'll hear a longer discussion I had with Goudreau's close friend and business partner, Drew White. The world first learned of Jordan Goudreau on May 1st, when the Associated Press reported that Venezuelan opposition leader Juan Guaido had contracted his services in order to plan a raid on Venezuelan military bases that would ultimately culminate with the arrest of President Nicolas Maduro. At the time, Goudreau, CEO of the private security firm Silvercorp USA, refused to acknowledge the plot's existence. But all of that changed on Sunday, May 3rd, when the world awoke to news that Venezuelan security forces had neutralized an attempted maritime invasion carried out by what it described as, quote, terrorist mercenaries, resulting in the deaths of all eight combatants. Hours later, Goudreau surfaced to tell Miami-based media outlet Factores de Poder that he was in fact responsible for the botched raid, despite previously refusing to answer AP's questions about the alleged Guaido contract. Goudreau explained that he decided to come forward after his partners in the agreement failed to uphold their end of the bargain. Take a listen.
But I have never, ever in my life seen just the backstabbing and the level of complete disregard.
Nunca en mi vida he visto el nivel de traición.
For men in the field.
Goudreau went so far as to release parts of the $212 million contract, as well as audio recording of the moment he and Guaido signed the document. Since that interview was recorded on Sunday, Venezuelan security forces have detained at least 41 more of Goudreau's men, including two former U.S. soldiers, Luke Denman and Aaron Barry. After watching Goudreau's interview, I still felt that he hadn't been given the opportunity to tell his full version of events. He described the AP report as a hit piece, and to be honest, I and many others who read it got the sense there were many more layers to the story. I also noticed the way Goudreau seemed to think of Venezuela's opposition as corrupt and backstabbing, but was never allowed to offer fuller details. I related to Goudreau's sentiment, having spent much of the last year reporting on the slimy and downright criminal nature of Venezuela's US-backed opposition. I believed Goudreau deserved the chance to expand on his complaints against Venezuela's opposition and thought he might benefit from a friendly hearing. So on Monday, I gave him a call. Here's our short exchange.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi, is this Jordan Goudreau?
Yes.
Hi, how are you? My name is Anya Parampil. I'm an independent journalist based in Washington, D.C.
Sure.
I'm sure you've been getting a lot of calls from reporters.
Oh, yeah.
I'll just tell you a little bit about myself since I'm not trying to catch you or trick you or anything. If you look me up, you'll see all of my reporting. I spent much of the last year focused on Venezuela. I spent about 2 months in Venezuela, and I've reported extensively on kind of the way that the opposition and some of its figures act. They're usually pretty backstabbing and unorganized, which has been supported by the story which has come out regarding you recently.
Right.
And right. So I just thought maybe if you'd want to talk to me and give me more of your side of the story, I would be really interested in hearing it, because I saw today, for example, that there were eight more arrests in Venezuela, and two of the people arrested were actually Americans, and you referenced...
They're my guys.
Yeah, do you know their names or who they were?
Yeah, Yeah, I mean, it's already been put out so much. I would definitely talk to you tomorrow if you have time, because I'm kind of in the middle of containing this crisis. But I can give you more of an in-depth, you know, background and history and whatnot.
Yeah, no, I'd really appreciate that. And I think I noticed in the interview you did yesterday, you were trying to kind of give more details about the way you felt backstabbed and betrayed by some of the people involved.
Oh, absolutely.
And absolutely. I felt like you didn't really get to talk about any of that.
Yeah, I'll definitely tell you. I think I will talk tomorrow.
Okay. Is there a good time for you?
Just call me anytime. During the day, I'll be awake and working, I'm sure.
Goudreau seemed nervous, but I think he sounded genuinely open to having a conversation. However, he did not answer any of my calls on Tuesday, nor replied to my messages since. It's very possible he's extremely busy, or that he decided he didn't want to speak with me. But while I waited for his reply, we at the Grayzone did some more digging, and we're able to get the phone number of Silvercorp's chief operating officer, Drew White. White lives in Colorado Springs, a good distance away from Melbourne, Florida, where both Silvercorp and Goudreau himself are based. As you'll hear in our conversation, White says he broke with Goudreau as a result of this boneheaded plot, telling me he thought it sounded insane. But most importantly, White said he was uncomfortable with the plan because its leaders did not have any concrete U.S. government backing. He said although Goudreau claimed to have a State Department contract, the legal side of things simply did not add up. He said he hoped his dear friend, Goudreau, the best man at his wedding, would not go through with the plan. But unfortunately, he did. And now two of their friends, men they served with overseas, are in Venezuelan custody. So what exactly drove Jordan Goudreau to follow through on this batshit operation? And what did the State Department know? All after my thoughts, after you listen to my conversation with Drew White.
Drew.
Hi, Drew White?
Yes.
Hi, how are you? My name is Anya Parampil. I'm a journalist based in Washington, D.C., I'm calling because I saw that you are listed as the COO on a corporation called Silvercorp USA. And,
very familiar, correct.
And I was wondering, I mean, I guess you know the question, if you had any thoughts about what's been going on in the news lately regarding Silvercorp and Jordan. I've been trying to reach him, but I'm just curious what exactly you think about what's gone on in Venezuela. Were you aware of any of this?
I've been talking to you, the media that calls when I catch it. I mean, my position in it and involvement is pretty transparent. So Silvercorp started as a company to provide school security, transitioning special operations soldiers and law enforcement, putting the schools to prevent active shooter events, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that was going, it's starting to work out, and then we broke ways. He started contracting overseas. And then he contacted me about, this Venezuelan operation, which appeared at the moment to be a State Department operation, right? Well, as I started to look into it, the contract didn't line up, so we just broke ways there. And then I didn't, get involved with the actual operation or any of it, really. It just didn't seem like a sanctioned operation, so.
Right, so why do you say it was State Department?
It was a contract that was prepared as a State Department contract, but I just didn't see it as that. It did not appear to be a State Department contract.
But he was trying to suggest it was?
Yeah, I mean, he was said it was. Yeah, I mean, he said it was.
Do you think that maybe even though it wasn't officially a State Department contract, that there were U.S. official involved, U.S. official...
Zero. As far as I can tell, there's no U.S. involvement in this at all.
So what exactly was Jordan's relationship with Keith Schiller?
I'm not sure. Apparently they've talked, but I'm not privy to it. I don't know the relationship. I've never met the guy. I've never talked to him. I was just told that there was a relationship.
Yeah, it seemed that Jordan has done security for Trump events.
Yeah, I mean, security is actually from everywhere. Doesn't need affiliation, but there was nothing, essentially, it appears that there might have been something with Gallego, you know, the actual sitting who's recognized as a president. But as far as the U.S. working with Silvercorp, I've never seen a State Department contract ever.
Mm-hmm. But he didn't mention that he even was speaking with U.S. officials or that they were supporting it, other than just the vague, like, references to Schiller.
Correct.
So you're not in contact with him, or have you spoken with him since all of this went down?
No, I mean, it's been a while since we talked. So, I mean, I don't know a bunch other than, hey, you know, we started originally as a school security company, and then now it's named in this. So,
what is Jordan like?
Great guy. I mean, he was the best man at my wedding. Close personal friend. Love the guy. Just don't know where this direction, honestly. I'm just sort of at a loss of words at this point.
Yeah, it's kind of concerning because it seems like he would even be maybe at risk for arrest or something like that right now.
Yeah, I'm just worried about him. And like I said, I love the guy. He's brother to me.
So why do you think he was got so caught up in the Venezuelan opposition? Like, did he tell you that they had, like, told him that this was a guaranteed surefire operation, that it would just take a little bit of support?
I mean, potentially had Gallegos backing him, you know, and I guess the assumption might have been that, you know, if that's the proposed, like, person to take over from Maduro, that maybe that seemed legitimate at that point. I know enough because of everything that's breaking now. I didn't think it would actually, you know, he talked about it, you know, okay, whatever. And then once we had heard about it and then it seemed that it wasn't a State Department activity, you know, that's when I was like, hey, I can't be a part of any of this. You know what I mean? Because I own several companies around here and, you know, I have my wife and kid and mm-hmm. they're my priority. So I'm like, look, man, like, it's just in the realm of legality. I'm not a lawyer, but I looked at him, like, it just didn't seem right to me. You know what I mean? I didn't have all the information on it, but for me, my gut check was like, I don't want to be a part of this.
Yeah, I understand. Do you do you have any idea where money may have come from? He mentioned crowdsourcing.
I have no. I mean, that's the part I heard, is that, you know, I guess these Uber drivers, other people I know on our end, no money was there. It wasn't legitimate from our standpoint. Doesn't mean that, you know, he showed other people other things where it might be legitimate. Right now it's so open-ended. I know him as the best man at my wedding and close friend and teammate. We served together overseas, all over the place, all over the world. And, you know, I just, seeing this guy, I woke up just on Friday.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and saw all this stuff breaking after the talk, and then actually a live operation went down, and Luke Dimon and Aaron Berry were teammates of mine, so Mike is...
I was going to ask you about them. I mean, it's crazy now because
Luke Dimon's a close personal friend of mine.
So, did you speak with them before they were getting involved in this, or did they tell you about
went off. I mean, they didn't really, everyone was, like, pretty closed, you know, closed on it. Obviously, I've essentially told anybody that was looking at it that it did not seem viable. You know, I'm like, this doesn't, yeah. I wouldn't, you know what I mean? Like,
it just seems a little crazy.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, I look at it, I'm like, but I don't know the whole story. You know, I don't know what I don't know. I just look at it from the outside and what was presented to me, you know, as a business decision. I'm like, this doesn't make any sense. I'm out. You know, I don't want anything to do with it. So I want to do school security. That's what I want to do.
Yeah, this is a big leap from that. So did the two other men, the ones who are now detained, there's been rumors floating in Venezuela that one of them is a DEA agent, that one of them said that they had connections.
DEA agent. They're both prior service special forces men. So they're both Luke and Aaron are both Green Berets, have no attachment to the DEA or CIA office.
And there were also claims that they were connected to Trump security as well.
None of them.
Do you get the sense that Jordan maybe wanted to do this in order to prove himself to the Trump administration, or like make himself into the next Eric Prince, something like that?
No, he's Jordan. Jordan is he's a guy. He's an intelligent guy. I truly believe that. Like honestly, I mean, he did this for. I think he truly believed that him removing Maduro is better for the people there. Like, honest to God.
I believe that, but I just think...
I mean,
even...
I don't think that he had any... I think he sort of maybe... I don't know if there was a conversation that he had with people from the MS. I don't know. You know, I don't know what I don't know again. But from what I from him is that... I mean, he has spent a lot of time in South America. I think he grew an attachment for it. And I think that he thought he was doing what was right.
In Colombia or where?
He was started on Columbia, then, which is that Brunson concert we did security for.
Yeah,
I think that's when that all opened up.
Do you know how he ended up with that contract?
He was doing contracting in either the Dominican or Puerto Rico, and he had a contact there that got him involved with that.
Mm-hmm. And so from that point, he kind of met the Venezuelan opposition, and I understand.
That's what I'm thinking. Again, I'm a mortgage and insurance guy. So, you know, I did 12 years in special operations. It's a past life for me. I've separated from it and my family. I don't know. Like, I have no clue, honestly. I took it, you know, he's a good friend. It's like one of your friends that calls you for 3 months, right?
Mm-hmm.
You just pick up where you left off, and, you know, I just was making sure that he's okay. That's what I cared about. I was like, you know, I've had a lot of friends, you know, die or kill themselves or whatnot. So my biggest thing is I just want to make sure that the guys are okay. Like, when they call, they are, but hey, I'm over here. It's South America. Are you okay? Yeah, I'm okay. It's like, okay, that's all I need to know.
Yeah.
Like, that's all I care about.
Yeah. I guess I understand why, what you're saying about him being so convinced that he, you know, removing Maduro is the right thing. And I think a lot of people feel that way. But it takes something else to actually go this far after, especially because last year there was a failed military uprising. Like, and I can tell you, I've spent a lot of time in Venezuela, like, as and people who do understand the situation would look at this plot and say it's totally absurd. So I wonder.
No, I agree. I just, you know, as someone who's been in, you know, for myself personally, Africa, Afghanistan, Iraq, you know, multiple places across the world, doing this stuff and working with them. I just don't see anything more than the fact that I truly believe that. Yeah, I'm sorry, I'm just distracting out to see the news talking about all this crap.
Oh, yeah.
In my office.
It must be surreal.
But he is a true believer, as we say it in where we come from. Like,
in the military?
He believes in the old, you know, like, people should be free, they should not be oppressed. It's like, that's what he believes in. Who supports it or whatever didn't matter to him. I mean, he came out and said it. Essentially, he's like, hey, look, I did this for no money. I have no clue what's going on, right? But I don't know. Like, I just don't know what he's doing. But I just don't see him being attached, from what I could see, to any administration in particular. From what that's just me looking at it.
Mm-hmm. Did you ever meet any of the Venezuelans he was dealing with or hear about them?
No. I got pulled into this because, you know, I was listed as the COO for the school security project.
Yeah.
I guess he refiled again, and, you know, I've had threats against myself and everything on social media.
I'm sorry about
that.
I'm
waking up to this on a Friday. I'm like,
yeah, I'm sorry about that. It's really, I mean, I think everybody was shocked because it was so insane, but I can't imagine, have this personal relationship with him. What would you want to say to him now?
Oh, I love the guy. Let's hope he's,
I hope he's okay.
Yeah?
I hope he's okay.
Absolutely.
But so you haven't tried to get in touch with him?
No, I mean, again, I mean, that's what I told people. It's like, look, my responsibility is to my family.
Yeah, totally.
But the thing is, like with Jordan, my thing is he's such an intelligent guy. Like, I don't know what's going on. If he was misled and something happened, you know what I mean? Like, it just, none of it adds up to me. It's just like in the first AP article, that's what I said. I was like, none of this makes sense to me.
Yeah. I think that's a lot of us. And it seemed like someone was, well, all of the media is kind of like attacking him, and it's like it's trying to blame him alone for it.
Yeah.
Forget about the Venezuelan opposition. And I mean, I would still like to ask Jordan if maybe there were U.S. officials coaxing him along, maybe not directly supporting him, but maybe giving him confidence.
Yeah, and the thing is, I mean, we've seen what happens. You know, like, these guys, I mean, you don't know. So, everything's just so, it's just, I don't know. I feel bad for the guy. I mean, I hope that, you know, in the end, he's exonerated. I have some anger towards it for being listed on there. I mean, that pisses me off that, you know, my family's put in jeopardy and something I'm not involved with.
Mm-hmm.
It's been pretty wild, but honestly, the ultimate part for me is, one, like I said, security of my family, and that Jordan, Aaron, and Luke are just okay in the end, regardless of what happens or charges or whatever. I just want them to be able to, whatever, recover and do what they need to do and just be back in their families. Don't have to worry about it either.
So, yeah, do they have families?
Luke's mom, Kay, was today. I mean, those families, you know what I mean? Like, your parents.
Yeah, everybody's coming, right?
And, you know, I just, you know, just hearing, you know, Luke's mom, you know, write her statement was just heartbreaking. It's just ridiculous. The whole thing's ridiculous. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I hope it will de-escalate.
I really do. What's funny is, I just know what's true, and I don't worry about it. I don't have to remember anything. So I just speak what I speak because I saw what happened. I don't know the operational side, but I remember when it was brought up, and you know, I just wish the guys went back to doing the school security shit.
Now, I actually believe Drew White was being sincere in that interview and telling me his side of the story truthfully. He's clearly emotional about the situation and genuinely concerned for his friends involved, as well as the risk put on his own family. But as he said himself, he only knows what he knows and wasn't intimately involved in the plot. Still, his testimony raises several questions. Most importantly, why was Goudreau claiming to have a State Department contract? On Wednesday, Venezuelan President Nicolas Maduro gave a press conference in Caracas during which he claimed the U.S. State Department was indeed backing Goudreau. Moments later, AP reported the U.S. government had opened an investigation in Goudreau for failing to clear his activities with the State Department, while members of Congress were also starting to press the State Department on exactly how much it knew. So here's what we do know. The bulk of the planning for this attack, as well as the military training, took place in Colombia. I'd like to know how U.S. citizens could have been directing a private military operation in Colombia without the knowledge of U.S. Embassy staff in Bogota. And let's not forget that U.S. diplomats who formerly served in Venezuela are currently running their embassy out of the Colombian capital. Venezuela dismissed U.S. Chargé d'Affaires James Story last spring, following Washington's recognition of Juan Guaido. And since then, he's been running what the U.S. describes as a virtual embassy out of the U.S. diplomatic mission in Bogota. Yet just days before AP's report revealed details of Operation Gideon, Secretary of State Mike Pompeo sounded pretty confident that James Story and his staff would soon be moving back to Caracas.
In Venezuela, I'm pleased to report that the multilateral effort to restore democracy is continuing to build momentum. I've asked my team to update our plans to reopen the U.S. Embassy in Caracas so that we are ready to go. As soon as Maduro steps aside, I am confident that we will raise that flag again in Caracas.
So what did Pompeo know? And when did he know it? Did James Story ever participate in Goudreau's planning meetings in Colombia? Because for some reason, Goudreau was telling his best friend and business partner at the start that the State Department was backing his operation. And for some reason, Pompeo was gearing up his personnel for a return to Venezuela just days before Goudreau planned to launch his invasion of the country. These are the points and questions I would like to bring to Jordan Goudreau. I'd also like to ask who he thinks threw him under the bus and why. AP said it spoke with 30 sources familiar with Operation Gideon. Why did they blow Goudreau's cover? Goudreau's trouble began on March 26th, when the highest-ranking Venezuelan military defector involved in the plot, General Kleber Acala, abandoned ship and released a video on Twitter claiming that he was involved in a plan to invade Venezuela and arrest President Maduro. While he didn't give specifics, he said Juan Guaido had arranged the contract. That same day, the U.S. conveniently charged Alcala with narco-trafficking, and he turned himself into U.S. authorities in Colombia. But here's the thing. His arrest was so friendly that Colombia's attorney general went so far as to complain the U.S. hadn't followed proper procedure. The DEA even neglected to handcuff Alcala. It appears the U.S. was actually just helping one of its high-level collaborators escape Colombia safely. After that point, it's impossible to deny U.S. authorities had direct knowledge of the plot. At the very least, Alcala was squealing. On top of that, he was an AP source while in U.S. custody. There's no way that could have happened without U.S. approval. But for some reason, Operation Gideon still went ahead, even after the AP report exposed Goudreau by name. Why? It's possible that although the original plan had fallen apart, some people involved still wanted to use it as an opportunity to test the strength of Venezuela's military. And considering the U.S. soldiers involved were ultimately rounded up by Venezuelan fishermen, let's hope they don't try something more serious. As they did on February 23rd and April 30th of last year, Venezuela has once again demonstrated national unity as well as the strength of its armed forces and intelligence services in the face of outside attack. But that does not mean we can rule out further escalation from the United States. In fact, it could even be possible that this entire bizarre saga is just a small piece of a larger plan designed to spark more drastic action. Parts of it still just don't feel right. And Pompeo is already seizing the moment to ratchet up threats.
We're going to work on this. It's a consular matter in the sense of anytime there are Americans that are detained someplace, we'll work to get them back. We will start the process of trying to figure a way if in fact these are Americans that are there, that we can figure a path forward. We want to get every American back. If the Maduro regime decides to hold them, we'll use every tool that we have available to try and get them back.
Funny. I can think of lots of tools in the U.S. government, some really, really big tools for that matter. And that's the bottom line here. Whether or not you're someone deeply connected to the anti-war movement in Venezuela, or someone who's just pissed off that two U.S. vets are in Venezuelan custody, or even moved by the fear and emotion in Drew White's voice, then the only thing you have to blame is the U.S.'s disastrous and continuously failing policy in Venezuela. Because even if you somehow believe that no U.S. officials had any knowledge of this plot whatsoever, then the only explanation you are left with is that a madman in the midst of a midlife crisis hired some U.S. soldiers to invade his own country, all because the United States convinced him he was president. Either way, the only lesson here is that de-escalation and direct engagement with the actual government of Venezuela is the only logical path forward for the United States government, especially now that U.S. citizens are in Venezuelan custody after trying to invade the country and arrest or kill its president. How do you think that would have worked out if a group of foreigners tried that here in the United States? Maybe if we stop starving Venezuelans with crushing sanctions and trying to invade their country every few months, those two vets could be returned to their families. And maybe, just maybe, Venezuela could have the over $5 billion in assets stolen by the US and its allies back in its own hands. And then we could all just get along. Wouldn't that be great?